are worthy. As worthy as the lamb was slain, who has come to this earth to die on the cross for our sins. And the only thing that we have that's anywhere close to coming close to what you have for us is to give our lives right back to you. So, Father, I just ask you, just help us to worship you in spirit and in truth here this morning. Just come in among us and just dwell our praise. We just thank you for the fact that you are a God who promises to dwell our praise. And we just thank you for that. Father, I just ask that you just open up our hearts and our minds to the word this morning, that you would just speak to each and every one of us, and that because of what we hear this morning, our hearts and our lives would be changed. We just lift up all of these things in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you. 5:16 says, "In the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise your heavenly Father." And the song I'm singing today is just an encouragement to that. It is called "We Are" by Carrie Job.
Shame, every fear, every pain. Thank you, Aaron. I wanted to just take a couple of moments this morning. As we've worked our way through the book of Ecclesiastes, and we're nearing the end. We've got this week and next week, and we'll finish this study, which has been a real blessing to me. And today, the message has to do with youth, has to do with young people. And I thought it would be an appropriate day maybe to kind of focus on the youth of this church, and specifically those that will be graduating from high school this year, and wanted to just take a moment to recognize them this morning. And there will be our annual graduation picnic. We'll be the 18th up at Seven Points, but wanted to have that opportunity to just recognize everyone in front of the church today. So as I think there are five of you graduating this year, but I think not everybody's here this morning. But Corey McKay, if you would just stand up. Corey's graduating from Mount Union High School. Shiloh Witzel is graduating from Southern Huntington. Chelsea Herman is graduating from Southern Huntington. And then also Andrea Darby, who isn't here this morning. And Jonathan Pacheco is graduating from Huntington. He's also not here today. In fact, Leah, his mom Leah, has pneumonia. He was diagnosed yesterday. Did I miss anybody? Well, let's all give them a hand, a recognition. For the accomplishments, and we wish you well. And you know, I thought of you all as Aaron was singing there this morning. You are the light of the world. Your light that you've been shining has maybe been limited to, you know, mom and dad's basement or somewhere kind of local, and now your platform, your light is going to have an opportunity to shine a little farther, a little brighter, and we pray for you that God blesses you as you begin your next step, whether it would be college or the workplace, wherever it might be. You know, as we've gone through this walk through Ecclesiastes, it's a quest. It's a search for meaning and purpose in life. And Solomon, the great king, the wisest man that ever lived, one of the most wealthy men that ever lived, is conducting this search. And he has left no stone unturned as he's looked for meaning and purpose to find if there is the possibility of finding meaning in this life. As he refers to under the sun, he says over and over again, and he's talking about our earthly existence. Is it possible to have purpose and meaning in our life here on earth? And he begins his quest back in chapter 1. He said, it's meaningless. Life is meaningless. And the rest of the book is devoted to discovering whether that premise is true, whether his thesis is in fact the truth or not. And as he has approached the end of the book, there's been this progressive revelation of truth. A little bit at a time, he seems to come to understand the possibility of finding meaning and purpose, that it is possible to experience meaning in this life. And he has made many mistakes in his life. And as he has started out, his life began with so much promise. As he is late in his life, and it appears that he's reflecting back on his life. And he wants that his experience to be a teachable moment for your life. He looks back at the many mistakes that he's made with his relationships and choices that he's made. And he wants you to benefit from that. And I can understand that. Because I think every parent has that same thought in their mind that, I've done some dumb things in my life. I've made some poor choices. And that should, in some way, that experience should help my child to make better decisions in their life. And as much as we want that to be the case, doesn't seem to work that way. It seems like our kids oftentimes have to kind of live and learn, make their own mistakes. But Solomon is using his hindsight, he's using his experience to demonstrate to us the frailty of life, the brevity of life, and the fact that it is possible to find meaning and purpose in this life. And you know, is this message today is going to really focus on young people. He approaches the end of this investigation, and now for whatever reason he's going to hone in on youth, on young people, and he speaks specifically to young people, has some great truths for young people. But before you tune me out, because you might say, well, I'm way past young people, I'm no longer in that category, I want you to think in these terms, that maybe you're not 17-year-old looking for the life that's before you, but maybe you're a parent, and you want to lead your child into making good decisions in their life, into finding meaning and purpose for them in this life, or maybe a grandparent. And so this truth is still still important to you also. And maybe you're none of the above. I'm not a youth. I'm not a mom or dad. I'm not a grandparent. Where does this apply? Well, we need to understand that as a ministry of this church, that much of what we do here as a body of believers focuses on young people. And this message today is going to point out why that's so critical, why it is so important that the ministry of this church is dedicated greatly to reaching young people's lives, to touching children and youth with the gospel of Christ. And we're going to look at that today as we continue the search, as we continue to walk through the book of Ecclesiastes. And I want to begin with this kind of overview statement that's on your bulletin. And it's this, it's that purpose and meaning are found when we connect with our Creator. And the best time to do that is while we are still young. And he's going to go through that with us, why it is important that we connect with the Creator while we are young, the hazards of not doing so, and the great implications that it has for us as individuals, and it has for us collectively as a church. Before we begin in God's Word this morning, though, let's bow for a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for this trek through the book of Ecclesiastes. We thank you, God, for the truths that have been applied each week. We thank you, God, for choices that have been made, decisions that have been made as a result, Lord, of the directives from Solomon in the lives of many people here in this church. We would pray today as we continue that, as we open your word, that God, you would just touch our lives in a special way today. You would shape us. You would change us. You would help us to understand, Lord, the incredible urgency of connecting with our Creator. And we thank you, Lord, for this time this morning. And we pray these things all in Jesus' name. Amen. We are in chapter 11, beginning at verse 7. And Solomon says this. He says, life is sweet, and it pleases the eyes to see the sun. Now, you know, kind of an encouraging, uplifting way to begin his talk today. What most, or a lot of what we've looked at through Ecclesiastes is almost in a depressing kind of point of view. But a lot of it is focused on the need to see the beauty of this world, to see the beauty of life, and to enjoy this life. And so he begins with this, life is sweet, life is good, life is a good thing. It's to be enjoyed. And he goes on to say this, however many years anyone may live, let them enjoy them all. But let them remember the days of darkness, for there will be many. Everything to come is meaningless. He makes some very important points just in this little couple of verses. And one is this, that life is finite. That there is a limited amount of time that we're granted. He says that you enjoy this life however long it might be that you live, leaving open the possibility that it could be short, or it could be long, or it could be somewhere in between. But there's no guarantee that life is going, we're going to get 75, 80, 85 years. We don't know. God makes it very clear to us that there are possibilities that our life isn't really that long. And so Solomon says that life is sweet, that we are to enjoy life however long it might be. There is a finite nature to the amount of time that we have. And he also puts this in there, that life is hard. He talks about darkness. He says, enjoy the life that's been given you, and know this, that there are going to be difficult times come. Now, if you've lived long at all, you know the reality of that. That there are hard points in our life. The life is to be enjoyed. The life is beautiful. There's an amazing world that we live in, and yet there are painful, difficult periods in our life. It's part of the the seasons of life that he spoke of in chapter 3. Do you remember that? There's a time for, and he goes through the list of the various seasons of our life, and the fact that there is a time for everything that we experience, and that there is beauty to be found in each of those seasons of life. And he's kind of reflecting on that here, reiterating his words here in chapter 11. And Solomon says, in light of that, in light of the fact that life is brief, that life is finite, that life can be hard, in light of those facts, enjoy life. You know, I think that sometimes we really send out the wrong signal about what it means to be a follower of Christ, what it means to be a believer, that boy, that's the dull life. Can't be much fun in that. And yet, the picture that Solomon gives us that comes from God is that life is fun. Life is to be enjoyed. It shouldn't be a drudgery. It shouldn't be just barely able to get out of bed and go every day, but should be enjoyed. And so he begins with this truth, and it is that life is short. Rejoice in all the days of your life. Life is short. Rejoice in all the days of your life. Rejoice means enjoy it. Have a good time. Life should be something that we're glad that we have been blessed to be a part of. Enjoy life. And Solomon has told us that over and over again through the book of Ecclesiastes. Even though there are those depressing, sometimes despondent moments that he speaks of, throughout he has this theme that life is to be enjoyed, that it should be fun to live as a human being. And he begins then in verse 9 with this. He really begins to hone in on those of you who are young. He says, you who are young, be happy while you are young, and let your heart give you joy in the days of your youth. You know what? When I look back on my youth, and not that I would want to go back to my youth, but it is a fun time. Being a kid, being a teenager, being a college student is a fun time. You know, our health is usually at its peak. We are physically and mentally probably as sharp as we'll ever be. And so it is a time to be enjoyed. And Solomon says, look, you who are young, enjoy it. Enjoy this time of your life, this season of your life. And he says this, he says, follow the ways of your heart and whatever your eyes see. And before you think, all right, everything is on. Everything is open. He has given me the okay to anything that I want. Follow your heart. Follow your dreams. Follow your desires. But then he follows that with this. But know that for all these things, God will bring you into judgment. You know, he's saying to us, follow the ways of your heart. See those things that you desire and go after them. And so if you are a senior in high school and you're ready to embark, he's saying, whatever you are passionate about, whatever you love, whatever you desire, man, put every effort into completing that. Don't live with regret. Don't get 15 years down the road and think, man, I just wish I would have gone to college. I wish I would have tried that business that I wanted to do. He's saying, go for your desires. Go for the dreams that you have. But just a word of caution, that so that we don't misunderstand that. He puts a fence around it. He puts some parameters around this command to enjoy, to seek the desires of our heart. He says that all these things God will bring into judgment. And what he's saying is that your choices the desires that you chase should be within the parameters, the guidelines that God has given us. And so if your desire is something that is completely contrary to what the Bible says, then obviously it's not to be pursued. But if it is not contradicted by God's words in Scripture, man, go for it. Chase after the dream that God has put on your heart, whatever it might be. He's not recommending unrestrained passion, but he is telling us to pursue those things that you're passionate about. Life is short. Reach for your dreams. Life is short. Reach for your dream, your dreams. And how can I know that my dreams are what God's dreams are for me? How do I know? He's saying, chase after your dreams, pursue the things you're passionate about, but how do I know that the things that I'm passionate about, the things that I dream about, are what God wants for me? We ask the wrong question. We ask the question, and we can even do this, we can first convince ourselves that what I desire is what God desires for me. We could look at this verse and say, well, since God is saying, chase after those things that you're passionate about, chase after whatever it is that you desire, I could take that as an indication that anything that I desire is okay with God. And yet, we ask the wrong question. When we ask the question, what is God's will for my life? How do I pursue God's will for my life? We're asking the wrong question. I want you to turn to Psalm 37, verse 4. And it says this. It says, delight yourself in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. Here's what we do. We identify the desire, and then we chase after the desire, asking God to put His stamp of approval, put His blessing on our desire. And yet, that's backwards. Because what the Scripture says is, delight in God, and He will give you those desires that are appropriate and right. Don't try to make God fit into your desires. In fact, when we chase after God's will, when we pursue our dreams, it is not by pursuing God's will for our life, but by pursuing God. When we pursue God's will, we are chasing the wrong thing. You pursue God, you develop your relationship with God, and in that, He makes your desires what He would want them to be. And then you have the unrestrained ability to pursue your dreams and your desires. Too many times we get that backwards. And we want what we want, and then we want God to work with that. We go to God, and in our relationship with God, He gives us the desires that are right, the desires that He wants for us, and out of that, we can pursue the dreams and desires that we might have. And so, we can't go to God and say, bless our desires. We go to God, and we say, God, give me Your desires. And in that, we have the freedom to pursue whatever is before us. And then to verse 10, he says this, so then banish anxiety from your heart and cast off the troubles of your body, for youth and vigor are meaningless. Just kind of to make sure, this word meaningless, this vanity, it has a couple different meanings in the book of Ecclesiastes. And one of them is, it means basically, it's the same word as vapor. And it means that it's brief. It's gone quickly. And so here, that's what he's talking about. He's saying that don't get worried. Don't be anxious. Don't be troubled by the pains of life, because life is brief. It's not that long. Or in fact, I shouldn't say life. He says youth. Youth and vigor is brief. It's not here long. You might think at 20 years of age that, man, you know, I am going to be healthy And this is going to be forever. And all of a sudden you're 50 and you think, where did it go? And Solomon is saying, since life is brief, since it is here and gone quicker than you realize, since the time that you are a child and a youth will pass quickly, since that is true, do not spend your life worrying and anxious and troubled by the pain of life. You know, you might even think that, boy, when I get out of high school, when I head off to college, then my anxiety will be gone, that my troubles will be past. Well, there's like six people in the front row here chuckling this morning. And I remember those days. I remember the anxiety of tests and papers and the thought that this is the worst thing in the world that could be possibly I could be looking at. I still have a dream. I'm telling you this. I'm over 50 years old, and I still have a dream that I show up to class and I miss the test. I still dream that. It was a challenging time, and even teenage years are the same way. It seems like, oh man, this, if I don't get a date for the prom, you know, life as I know it will end. And Solomon says, life, youth is brief. Don't consume it with worry and concern and anxiety. And the other thing is this, maybe your thoughts are, man, when I get out of college, when I get out of high school, I'm going to get me a good job, and then it's going to be easy. I'm going to be riding the gravy train the rest of my life. And I can tell you from the adults that sit around here, it doesn't work that way either. That there is always worry, there's always anxiety, there's always something to be concerned about. And Solomon says, do not waste your life anxious and worried. In fact, in Philippians chapter 4, he specifically tells us not to be anxious, not to be worried. You know, I guess I have to quote those great theologians, Timon and Pumbaa, Hakuna Matata. There's a great truth in that Solomon is telling us here, that we should not spend our lives just fretting and worried and anxious, but to enjoy the life that God has given us. And as a young person, enjoy the youth and the vigor that you currently have. This week I was my shoulder started bothering me to the point where I couldn't sit. I would sit and I would drive the car, and I was like, I couldn't get in a position where my shoulder wouldn't hurt. There were not that many years ago, that would never even cross my mind, and yet that's what happens. Our bodies get older, and he says, enjoy the youth and the vigor that you have while you have it. And then he moves to chapter 12, and though it's continuing the same truth. And he says this. Actually, I think I skipped the point, didn't I, Corey? Life is short. Reject the worry. Okay. Chapter 12. See, there's the benefit of youthfulness. Chapter 12, verse 1 says, remember your Creator in the days of your youth, before the days of trouble come and the years approach when you will say, I find no pleasure in them. Life is short. Remember your Creator. Life is short. Life is brief. Do not neglect God in your life. You know, so many people hear the gospel and they don't respond to it. And their thinking goes something like this. You know what? I'm 19 years of age. I gotta do that whole party thing yet. I got this girlfriend that I want to do stuff with that I know that God wouldn't permit. So I'm going to just put that decision off. I'm going to just push that down the road a little bit. I'm not going to make that decision to connect with God at this moment in life, but I have every intention of doing that at some point in my life. And Solomon says, remember your Creator in the days of your youth. Remember your Creator before the years approach when you say, I find no pleasure in them. There's a kind of a difficult thing here, but what he's saying is that as we get older and move further along, there is less and less a likelihood of us coming to a relationship with Jesus. It becomes less and less likely that we follow Christ. And we might have every intention. Say, you know what, I'm going to make that decision. I believe in God. I'm just not ready to just embrace Him right now. And so we push it down the road, and we push it down the road, and something happens in our life. In fact, life happens. And that becomes less and less likely. Statistically, as a person ages, they are less likely to come to Christ. You can find all kinds of statistics on that. 85% of people who are in a relationship with Christ will do so before the age of 14, which means the further along you go, the less likely that it is you come into a relationship with Christ. I stopped to visit a man down at Woodland, and I started, shared with him. I was the chaplain and just began to kind of talk to him a little bit, and he said, I don't believe that stuff. And I said, you don't believe in church, you don't believe in God, you know, you know exactly what he was saying. Yeah, I don't believe in anything, I don't believe in God. And I noticed just a harshness, a bitterness, a cynicism that has been the result of life. It's been 80 years of life, of pushing God down the road, and life has come up and crept up on him. And at this point, it would take an absolute miracle from God for him to see his need for the Savior. And yet, many people think that that's the road that they're going to choose. I'm going to make that decision, just not yet. And it really indicates that we, as a church, really have a kind of a window of opportunity. That there is a brief moment where we really need to reach these kids, because after that, it's going to become less and less likely. And it's why, when you look at our church and you look at our the budget and the bottom line, you're going to see a lot of money of our ministry is directed towards young people, towards kids, and towards youth. Because we see that as the prime time, the opportunity to reach them, recognizing that when they get to be a little bit older, it's going to be very unlikely that we're able to get a decision from them. And so we as a church really believe firmly in reaching kids. It's why Bible school this year, which we've kind of struggled with lately, and we decided we're going to do something different this year. Why? Because we see it as an opportunity to reach more kids, to reach kids in a way that we haven't before. We send kids on mission trips, and we try to do that every 2 years, and we're hoping next year to do the same thing. Why? Because that opportunity for them to be on the mission field, to see God at work in their life and the works of other people, or in the lives of other people, has an incredible, profound impact on their life. It's important that we invest in ministry to and for young people, and we'll continue to do that. You know, when the other thing is this, some of you guys are going to be heading off to college. And I'm sure most kids that go to college, that are Christians, would affirm this, would agree with this. The things that you have believed, the things that have been so important to you and your life as a Christian and growing up, those things are going to be challenged in college. That there's going to be people that are going to reject your belief, and they're going to challenge you on that. And so it is critical that at a young age you establish that relationship with Christ, so that when you walk in to that environment, and I'm not saying that you avoid that environment. I think Aaron sang about being the light of the world, and if we have an opportunity to be the light at Juniata College or at Penn State, or man, be the light. But you need to go prepared, because the things that you have held dear in your beliefs are going to be challenged. There's going to be some difficult moments as you work through some of those truths. And so Solomon's saying, as you have an opportunity to connect with God, to connect with your Creator, do it now. And then he goes on to kind of tell us why. And in verse 2, it says this: before the sun and the light and the moon and the stars grow dark and the clouds return after the rain. I think there's a couple of points here. One is this, that sin has a way of darkening our days later in life. in a couple ways. Both, there's a physical toll that sin has on your life. And if you reject God and you live for your flesh, you live for your physical being, party, enjoy all the relationships that I could, there's a physical toll that comes from that sin. And the other thing is this, that there's a spiritual toll. There's a beating down of your spirit that causes you later in life to not see God as critical and as important in your life. And whether it's just the cynicism of life or it's just the absolute physical and emotional toil or tear of sin on your life, it still impacts our life beyond the moment that we live in. J.C. Ryle is a famous pastor and theologian, and he said something that I think is very profound. He said, "Sin is the mother of all sorrow, and no sort of sin appears to give a man so much misery and pain as the sins of his youth." The choices that we make at 15 and 16 years of age, choices that we make at 13 and 14, 17 and 19, 21 to 20, those sins bear consequences later in life. And they're painful, and they're difficult, and they bring challenge to our life, even though we're forgiven, even though the grace of God, the blood of Jesus has covered those sins, it never takes away the scar of those sins. And so it is critical that we live in a way that would be pleasing to God, in a way that would not be harming to our spirit in the future. He begins now what is maybe a somewhat depressing description of life, beginning at verse 3 through verse 7. And what it is, and maybe from your translation, maybe it's not apparent to you as you first look at it, but it's a description of what happens to the human body in life. It's what happens to us physically as we get older. And it's why he's saying, remember the Creator in the days of your youth before these things happen. Because when these things happen, it's going to be a lot harder to remember your Creator. You're going to be less likely to connect with your Creator after these things begin to happen in your life. And as we read down through them, it says this, "When the keepers of the house tremble and the strong men stoop, when the grinders cease because they are few and those looking through the windows grow dim, when the doors to the street are closed and the sound of grinding fades, when people rise up at the sound of birds but all their songs grow faint, when people are afraid of heights and of dangers in the streets, when the almond tree blossoms and the grasshopper drags itself along and desire no longer is stirred, then people go to their eternal home and mourners go about the streets. Remember him before the silver cord is severed and the golden bowl is broken, before the pitcher is shattered at the spring and the wheel broken at the well and the dust returns to the ground it came from and the spirit returns to the God who gave it." If you picked up on that or not, it is a description of the deterioration of our physical body. He says that when the strong men stoop, he's talking about the stoop of an older person. When the grinders cease, he's talking about your teeth. When your teeth fall out, it's a description of human body. The song, the birds singing in the morning wakes us up. Used to be able to sleep till 11. Now I can't get past 7:30. When the slightest sound wakes us up, and yet our hearing is gone, is what he says. When the almond tree blossoms, probably referring to white hair as our hair gets white. And he even goes as far as to say, and when desire is no longer stirred, and he's talking about sexual desire. The fact that time in life when that just isn't there anymore. And so it's this description of the aging process, of what happens to every human being who walks the earth. And he says, before that happens, before you experience the cynicism and the pain of getting older, get a hold of your Creator. Connect with the God who made you. And you know, I think there's a couple reasons, a couple things there too. Not only is he talking about a relationship with him, but he's talking about even the opportunity to live for him, to serve him. Last week we were talking about investing and the fact that someone will say, well, you know what, I'll get around to that. And this is part of the problem. I'll get around to that. And the reality is one of these days you're not even going to get around to that. That's the reality of the human existence. That there is a deterioration to the human body that is going to prevent us from doing those things that maybe we want to do. And so we might look at that and think, oh my goodness, Dan, could you have depressed me any more today? But he doesn't give us these words to depress us. He gives us these words to motivate us, to understand the brief nature of life, the window of opportunity that exists for you to know the Savior, the window of opportunity that exists for you to serve the Savior. You only got so much time. That's the truth of the human existence. And you better use that time wisely. And not think that I'm going to put that off to another day. But to live for him in total today. The final point is this. Life is short. Run to Jesus while you can. Life is short. Run to Jesus and run for Jesus while you can. You have a brief moment in history, as Scripture describes it. You only have so much time to do what God has called you to do. And so, pack as much as you can into that moment in history that God has given you. Live for Him, work for Him while it's still daylight. Let's pray. Father, we thank you today for this passage of Scripture. God, sometimes we need shaken, we need stirred, we need woke to the harsh reality of life, Lord. The truth of what it means to live under the sun, to live on this earth. And I pray today, God, that we would see that and we would passionately pursue that, Lord. That we would be the workers, the servants, the believers, God, that you have called us to be. And Lord, if there's anyone here today who has never called on you, who has never made you the Lord of their life, that God, that these words, these that have been spoken this morning will just touch their heart and bring them to that point of decision, Lord, to follow you, to make you the Lord of their life. We thank you today, Lord, and we pray these things all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's stand.
Because of fear, but the Holy of Holies.
2004, when I went to Costa Rica on my first mission trip, I'll never forget, we were sitting in a little worship session one night, and the project director was challenging us with a message, and he quoted this man, that had a profound impact on my life. And he said this, I think the guy's name was Miles Monroe, he was a pastor, and he said this, he said, I want to die empty. He said, I don't want to get to the end of my life with parts of me that are not used up, that are still full. He said, yeah, that's what I want. I want to die empty. And when I heard those words, it stirred in my heart just a desire to change something, to actually do something, to really look at my life and begin to see that I was cruising. That I was pacing myself, that I was somehow I had enough time to do everything that I wanted to do. And I would get through it when I got through it. And when I heard those words, it struck me of just the brief time of life. That the little bit of moment that God has given us to impact the world that we live. And it caused me to reevaluate my life, to make some decisions, and to begin truly doing those things that God had put before me to do. And I think it's the same words that Solomon is saying to us today. That you've only got a little bit of time. You've only got a brief moment to make your mark in this world. And you need to pour yourself in to whatever it is that God has put before you. And begin making an eternal difference in this world. And that's my challenge to you today. To leave here with the passion to do something. The passion to connect with your Creator today and begin to make a difference for Him in the world that you live. Let's pray together. Father, we thank You today for the power of Your Word. Thank You for the harsh, incredible truth of Scripture, Lord. And that, God, that would motivate us to know You and to live for You and to make a difference for You, Lord, here in the world that we live. We thank You, God. We love You. And we pray these things all in Jesus' name.